Sing praises to God, O faithful ones. Give thanks to God's holy name. You have taken away our funeral clothes and reclothed us in joy, so that our whole being, body, mind, and soul might sing praises to you and not be silent. O Lord, our Lord, we will give thanks to you forever. Let us pray. Almighty God, our world is filled with corruption and injustice. Power disguises itself as truth. Selfish pleasures parade as love. And we confess that we get caught up in all of this confusion. When Jesus, our risen Lord, first appeared to his disciples, they were confused. Then they recognized him when he broke bread. Open the eyes of our hearts that we may recognize his presence and experience the joy of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray together, praying the prayer that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. A reading from Luke. Now on that same day, two of them were going to the village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all the things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer those things and then enter into his glory? Then the beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interrupted to them the things about himself and all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning with us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?' That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions to gather together. They were saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had made known to them in the breaking of the bread." This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
Oh, That's good morning. Thank you for being here today. And as always, we thank God for God's holy word. Okay, so now we're looking at Luke today. And in his account of the Easter events, Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women had gone to Jesus' tomb to anoint his body with spices, and then they saw that his body was missing. So in Luke's account, he goes into all those details. And two angels told them that Jesus wasn't there and had risen on the third day. So the women were terrified by this vision, and who wouldn't be if you go expecting one thing and then you see something very just crazy? So they ran back to tell the other disciples what had happened. And naturally, no one believed them, thought they were just telling some wild stories. It was much too surreal. So that's the context. That's what happened immediately before the passage for today. And so now we have two of those disciples who were there hearing these crazy, wild stories that the women were telling, and they were headed back to their village called Emmaus. So I'm guessing that that 7-mile walk that they were taking felt much longer than usual. It's long enough anyway, but they had earlier gone to Jerusalem with very high expectations for their Messiah. And now there was hopelessness and sadness and all the experiences that they had been through since then. They've just experienced the death of their beloved leader. And so the grief must have been absolutely overwhelming. And I've talked about this in other contexts in the last couple of weeks with some of the various disciples. And so that walk along Emmaus would have been a good time for them to talk with each other. And I know this for myself, that when I've experienced the death of someone whom I love very much or experienced a deep tragedy, sometimes I just like to go for a walk to process, to clear my head, to think about things, and to just feel the grief. And so I'm guessing these two people were walking along, trying to think about what lay ahead for them in their daily lives now that Jesus was gone. And I suspect they were going home with heavy hearts. They had been on this long and hopeful journey with Jesus, whom they thought would liberate them from all the oppressive forces that had kept them down, and now he was gone. Or was he? So when the stranger suddenly approaches them and asks them, "Well, what are you talking about? What are you discussing?" It stops them dead in their tracks. "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who doesn't know what has happened?" And so they tell him about all that has happened to Jesus. And then what does he do? He responds with a lecture about all the prophecies, going back to Moses, to the more current prophecies and prophets, and yada, yada, yada. I mean, it's kind of like listening to someone up here preaching, isn't it? Yeah. I can just imagine a stranger coming up to me when I'm deep in thought and conversation, grieving, and telling me all this, you know, giving me this lecture about prophecies, and I can just see my eyes rolling back in my head and going, "Yeah, yeah, yeah, but you don't know about those terrible things that have happened recently, and you don't know about our pain. We had hoped Jesus would redeem Israel, and instead he was executed, and now we don't know what to do. We don't know what the future holds for us." So when they get back to their village of Emmaus, Jesus, you know, he keeps on going, but they asked him to stay with them. Now, I have to do an aside here. We often picture these two disciples as being men, but it may have been a married couple. There may have been a woman there. Leave it to a woman to bring this up, you all right? But only Cleopas was named, and it's possible that he could have been journeying with his wife because they're going home and then they're preparing supper to invite him in. So I'm picturing more of a, of a domestic scene here. Could be two men, but it could also have been a man and a woman. Anyway, that's my aside. Okay. So while they were having supper, Jesus broke the bread and blessed it, and they recognized him. It probably took them back to that last supper that Jesus had shared with his followers before his trial and execution, because I'm guessing they were there. They were there with all the disciples, all the followers. And now they realized that Jesus had not left them. He had been walking with them on the road to Emmaus and was with them in their home sharing a meal with them. And did they dare to think that maybe he will always be with them? Maybe he didn't leave them after all. Maybe he will always be there for them. Well, I thought, how fitting is it that the assigned scripture for the lectionary for today is the story of the disciples on the road to Emmaus? Because we've all been on a journey together, right? So I brought my walking stick out. I've had it out here every Sunday right by the pulpit to, just as a reminder for those of us who even notice it there and for myself, that I came in as a temporary sojourner with you, and I'm going to take my walking stick and then sojourn out. We've been on this road together to discover what Jesus has to say to us. This is one of my favorite passages. The stole I'm wearing is from Emmaus. In modern times, we don't really know exactly where the location of Emmaus is. To be truthful, there are several places that could have been the historic Emmaus. This one is from Emmaus Nicopolis, and there's an area in Palestine, Israel, where that has seen a lot of tragedy. As recently as the 1967 war, the Israeli government, the military, came through and completely demolished the town of what was historic Emmaus as one of the possible sites. And then they've rebuilt. Now there is the French Catholic community of the Beatitudes, a group of priests who are taking care of this one area there. And they're the ones who wove this stole. So I was really privileged a number of years ago to visit this site, and it was before I was ordained, and so I packed it away and kept it safe, hoping for that day when I could wear it. And so now, when I do wear it, I think back to those priests and that time and the historical Emmaus, the difficult situations that they have been in since, and how Emmaus continues to speak today. Well, Jesus, as I said earlier in the passage, he was going to go on. He did not force himself into their home. He didn't invite himself in. He did not enter uninvited. He laid out all the prophecies. He told them the story of faith, the good news that had been revealed in Scripture, and he was ready to move on. He was going to go on. Because faith and belief cannot be forced. You can't force it on people. But you can lay it out there and offer it and share it. So when someone tries to force their way in, isn't it our nature to lock and bolt the doors and be a little bit more resistant? When someone tries to push themselves on us, whether in friendship or courtship or business or work, don't our defenses go up if we don't quite know who they are or what their motives are? But the two Emmaus travelers invited Jesus into their home. He had shared a bit on this road to Emmaus with them, and they had an inkling that there was more to his story as their hearts burned within them, but they weren't quite sure why that was. They weren't quite sure. And so they invited him in, and in their house, in their home, they experienced the fullness of Christ's story, his message of life over death, his message of hope for the least of these. These were revealed to them in their home after they had invited him in. It was in their home that they were able to recognize the significance of his story and who he really was. They recognized him. It was after they invited him into their home and shared a meal with him that their eyes were opened to the incredible miracle that had happened, that Jesus was there. He was no longer in the tomb. So I think this is how it is with our journey of faith, wherever that journey takes us. Periodically, God enters our lives when we don't quite recognize what's going on, when we may be down and out, when we're befuddled, when life seems like a total disaster, when we don't know what our next steps are going to be. But the encounter with God stops us in our tracks, just like those two people who were walking on the road to Emmaus. And then we may have an inkling that there's something significant going on here in this encounter, and we try and take it in. So while we're caught up in our own anguish, in our own story, we're pondering things that we don't understand, pondering our unfulfilled dreams, God suddenly appears and stops us and talks to us. Oh, hold on. What is God trying to tell us? What is that burning in our hearts? We're not quite sure what that is and what to do about it. And that's when we decide to open up our home, open up our hearts to this encounter, to try as best as we can to get on with our lives and to figure it out. And maybe if we open up our hearts, we'll find some revelation. It's in moments like these when we are vulnerable, when we decide to trust that stranger in our midst, to trust the divine encounter that catches us off guard, that we can see and experience the truth of the good news. It's in those moments. It is at those very moments when God is able to fully engage with us and cut to our very core. Well, Jesus knew the disciples' pain. He knew their anxiety. He knew the suffering that they had been through and would face in the future. He knew their questioning. He knew what that was all about. He knew their grief. He was there with them through it all, experiencing it himself. And he blessed them in their vulnerable moments, just as he broke the bread and blessed the bread. "This is my body, broken for you. I have been there in your pain. I am there in your questioning. And I am there with you now. And I am here with you now." Well, you are all on your own Emmaus journey, just as I am. We are all on our own Emmaus journey. And I am really, really grateful to you for having been able to travel with you for this short period of time. I feel that we've come a long way in our journey together, that it's been healing, it's been positive for all of us. I hope so. It has been for me. And there are many, many things that I still want to do with you. I still see some admin details and other things, pastoral stuff. I mean, there's just, it's never ending, isn't it? But the road leads us in a different way now, down a different path. You have welcomed me so graciously into your spiritual home. Thank you. And I want to also thank Vicky. And y'all need to thank Vicky. Vicky, just stand up for just a sec. Just a sec. Come on. I know, I'm putting you on the spot. Okay, you can sit down. Now, I need to tell you, Vicky is my housemate. Vicky opened up her home to me. She took a risk. She opened up her home. She opened up her heart to me. And it's because she did that, she gave me a place to live, a place of safety, a place of comfort, that I was able to come here and be with you. And so we owe her a deep debt of gratitude. Thank you, Vicky. Without you, none of this would have been possible. God would have had to find a different way. mahalo nui loa. So we don't know what the future holds in store for any of us, but we trust in God. You still have many challenges ahead of you, especially with this building. We hear about that, we talk about it regularly. But what I want to say is keep your hearts open. Watch for Christ along the road as you journey, because you have too much love to share to let it get swallowed up in these walls. You have too much love to share to let it get swallowed up by this building. So keep your hearts open. You have a capable and caring pastor who will be with you now. Thanks for being here today, Michael. Until you call your settled pastor, he will walk with you in your next steps as you all journey down the road to Emmaus. And you will have a new opportunity to encounter Jesus in a new way. And I shall be praying for you as I walk the streets of London and Piccadilly. Amen. Thank you. Let us join together in prayer. Let us pray. Our loving and resurrecting God, throughout history you encounter your people in their bewilderment and distress. You encounter your people as they journey down their spiritual path, not always secure or sure of where they are going or why they are even traveling. You continually uphold them with your love, even when they are not aware of your presence. For this, O God, we say Alleluia. We pray for pastors, teachers, ministers, elders, and deacons, that they recognize the risen Christ in word and sacrament and lead your church with wisdom, humility, and courage. We pray for the poor, the stranger, the refugee, the dispossessed, that they may receive a place of refuge and hope, and that the church may offer the hospitality the first disciples offered to Jesus on the road to Emmaus. We pray for the sick and those in distress, that they may find healing for their pain and be restored to fullness of life. We pray for our community, that we may all live together in peace and share our abundant resources with each other. And we pray for our enemies, that they may receive good things, and that we, your servants, not return evil for evil. And we pray for those named in our bulletin today. We pray for our concerns and our celebrations, out loud and in our hearts, reassured in the knowledge that you continue to walk with us. Almighty God, receive our prayers. We thank you for the time we have had to walk together in faith as your community at Trinity UCC. And O God, I especially thank you from the bottom of my heart. By the power of your Holy Spirit, continue to make us witnesses by our words and deeds to the glorious resurrection of Jesus Christ, so that the world may know of your love and peace. Alleluia. Amen. Is there, your heart will be also. Let us now take our tithes and offerings. Let us pray. Our gracious and loving God, we thank you so much that we have the opportunity to walk with you, to minister in your name. We ask that you please use these gifts that we humbly offer to you, that they may further the work of your kingdom. No matter what road we take, may we always be faithful to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, since we had some Hawaiian music today, I thought I would do the same benediction I did last Sunday. And I don't have it memorized, so I need this here. But again, it's the acrostic for aloha. Aloha meaning farewell, meaning hello, meaning God's blessings upon you. It's like the word shalom. And in English, kindness to be expressed with tenderness, unity to be expressed with harmony, pleasant are your thoughts, humility to be expressed with modesty, and patience to be expressed with perseverance. A ka hai e na Hawaii, lo ho kahi a kulike, olu olu kamana o, ha a ha a ko kulana, a ho nui a lana ki la. Aloha, aloha, aloha. Go in peace. Amen.